So I'll echo the good morning slash good afternoon and follow on from what Chris was talking about in terms of now that we have the geological information and have a better sense of the hazard, what we've been trying to do about it on both a policy level and an implementing policy level. So this is what we're going to be covering, and some of it is really just a pitch for the role of geoscience plays in policy development and then how we apply that. I know we have a pretty large audience today, and for those of you who are familiar with what's been going on in Oregon, some of this will be a little bit of review, but a few years ago we had a resolution passed in the Oregon House led by Representative Deb Boone, and it directed the Oregon State Seismic Policy Advisory Commission, OSPAC, so despite its acronym, it is a standing statutory committee, it's not a PAC, to create this Oregon Resilience Plan for the reasons shown in the red, you know, protect lives, keep commerce flowing, and it specified the scenario, the megathrust earthquake and tsunami. So the report was issued, it was a one-year process. You can see on the right, almost 170 volunteers, a budget of exactly zero. 1 year to get it done, we had 9 working groups. We based it on a single scenario, and we had water, wastewater, power, communications, transportation, et cetera. And those were the priorities there in that upper right box. So this is a scenario, the magnitude 9 Cascadia subduction zone. We divided the state into 4 broad zones, the tsunami inundation, and then the coastal area minus the tsunami, inland valleys, and finally eastern Oregon. And you know, the different types of damage, once you get away from the tsunami inundation, obviously in the coast, much stronger shaking in the inland valley. As Chris just alluded to, we're not looking necessarily at the intensity of shaking that they'll see on the coast, but certainly still a prolonged shaking and extensive liquefaction, which would be really, really devastating for this area given the buried infrastructure. Threw in a couple of pictures from other earthquakes because, you know, while it's been at the cost of other people in other areas, we've been able to learn a great deal from the large number of substantial earthquakes over the last 10 to 15 years. This is a picture from the Christchurch area from their substantial, it was not a subduction zone earthquake, but this used to be a residential subdivision that is now uninhabitable. You know, used to have to go farther to go to the beach than walking out your front door. So this type of liquefaction isn't just a temporary inconvenience. You know, there were, I think, close to 1,000 homes that were deemed unlivable. That means we can't build here again. And most areas this size, even larger, don't have that many available housing units to put people in. That's a significant problem. Certainly in our area, Portland metro area, you know, we have a very, very high occupancy rate. And that is true for a lot of the West Coast. That's going to be a problem if we have to condemn certain areas. More examples, some pictures from Yume Wong from Dogami and currently the Office of the State Architect, looking at the impact of weak soils. And this is a really big issue for us because, as I said, we may not get the really intense shaking. We'll probably get long-duration shaking, but the amount of liquefaction, especially in the Northern Willamette Valley, which is where a good portion of Oregon's population is really likely to be devastating. The bridges between the inland valleys and the coast, for those who do survive the tsunami, even if they don't collapse, I know I wouldn't want to be the first person to drive over them. And that's an ongoing weakness, and it's not something we're going to be able to change overnight. One of the reasons the Oregon Resilience Plan looked at a 50-year perspective is because we don't have tons of money and we can't just suddenly change all of our infrastructure. So it's going forward, how do we prioritize things? What do we want to do when we build new, when we replace? What are some of our options for both built and unbuilt? But it actually gets worse than that. It's not just the issue of the liquefaction and the strong shaking. It's the secondary effects and what that actually means to us. So, you know, for us, a lot of it comes down to lifelines, and that's one of the main issues with any earthquake. We have a lot of vulnerabilities. We have a lot of interdependent lifelines connected to each other, water, wastewater, electricity. We know that in our area, certainly the service area for my agency, the most densely populated part of the state, transportation system just between the damage to the bridges or the approaches to the bridges, the impact on the roadways themselves, the loss of power for traffic control. It's going to make it extraordinarily difficult to not only respond to emergencies, but simply to move supplies around, because if you can't distribute things by ground one way or another, simply relying on even large helicopters, just it's not practical as a sole source of distribution. And along with that, we have really extensive vulnerability as far as fuel that I'll show in a couple slides from now. But the having enough fuel to operate vehicles and emergency generators, we know we're going to run short of that. And while we're planning for that, there's only a certain amount that we can affect in advance. And then the last piece is that the challenge of, in this part of the world, we don't get a lot of major disasters. The Pacific Northwest coast, they get a lot of big storms, and they're far more accustomed to really disruptive events. But outside of that, you know, our last two presidentially declared disasters for the Portland metro area were snow and ice storms, and you know what amounts to a major inconvenience. So we're trying to generate awareness for a culture that A, isn't really used to disasters at all, B, has no collective memory of large earthquakes, and C, really only determined they were a seismic hazard zone really just a few decades ago. So we don't have a lot of cultural knowledge. Our codes are still catching up. We have a lot of old buildings. And unfortunately, within emergency management, emergency preparedness, a lot of the so-called best practices really amount to something that was derived from an area where events are more common and where they come with warning, i.e. Hurricane Alley. And a lot of those concepts, which are, you know, might not even reach the stage of expert opinion, don't apply well here. So it's not that we're making it up as we go along, but we have a lot of challenges in both creating functional protocols and alerting the public. We do a lot of exercises. My agency this year will be doing, again, and actually the states of Oregon, Washington, FEMA Region 10, will be doing a multi-day earthquake exercise for that same Cascadia scenario. We do no landline phones, no cell phones, no trunked 800 megahertz radio system for a full day, but we still can't simulate the difficulty in getting around, the challenge in getting people into work, the fear that people have for their loved ones, and just the really large-scale disruption. So a lot of different challenges in the what do we do about this side. Next couple slides are from the Oregon Resilience Plan itself, and it just shows where some of our vulnerabilities are. You can see on the horizontal axis the decade that our public schools, K-12, were built in green, the public safety buildings, and then the community colleges. And you look at where the median is, you can see where most of them are, and most of those were before we had any seismic codes at all. And it's really only a tiny portion that were built under modern seismic codes. So we have a lot of vulnerable buildings. This is from Nate Wood from the USGS, and it is directly applicable to the resilience plan. It shows the degree of population risk that we have in the tsunami inundation zone along the coast. What it doesn't show, which is also in the Oregon Resilience Plan, was about 80-85% of the critical infrastructure along the coast is in the inundation zone as well. So we're looking for really a catastrophic impact and a really long-term impact as well. The nice thing is that the Oregon statutes allow us, really encourage us to use science. The Oregon revised statute that was passed in the 90s that generated our initial restrictions for development in the tsunami inundation zone recognized that scientific evidence may improve in the years. And so there's a way to, since OGAMI has updated their maps, we don't need an act of the legislature to adopt those formally and make those the new lines of demarcation. And in fact, that will be starting during the current year. Here's the best way to summarize the ORP is this is a direct quote. We will have very large earthquakes. We are poorly prepared, and we need to do something about it. And that hasn't changed in the 2+ years since the plan came out, but we are starting to do something about it. We know that we're going to have large casualties. Most of the modeling programs like HAZUS, if you have enough site-specific information, are pretty good for projecting various types of damage, pretty bad for projecting casualty rates. But you know, this order of magnitude, 1 to 10,000 is certainly reasonable, quite a lot of them in the subduction zone. Huge economic loss, tens of billions of dollars, and of course that would affect the rest of the country, not just the state of Oregon. Huge amount of debris. The pictures in the bottom of the slide show the, our one large centralized fuel hub in Portland near Swan Island on the Willamette River. And that's fill. It is easily liquefiable soil. We don't have a lot of reinforced facilities there. So aside from the fact we probably lose a lot of those tanks, we also lose the fuel that's going to be filling the pipelines that supply a lot of our area. They supply the airports. They supply the liquid fuel lines that run through there. The pipelines themselves would likely be damaged. So aside from not wanting to swim downstream of this for a while, it really highlights our liquid fuel vulnerability, affecting our ability to respond and recover. And this is a USGS shot. It just viewed as a schematic. Don't worry about what color is what. But all those different lines, water, wastewater, electric transmission, natural gas pipeline, liquid fuel pipeline, highways, airports, those are all the lifelines in this area, much of which is at high risk for either liquefaction or at least amplified shaking due to soft sediments. And that's a lot of infrastructure to address. It's a lot of infrastructure to even inspect. So one of the things that we did about this was in the 2013 legislature, the same year that the Oregon Resilience Plan was presented, another bill was passed to create what we call the Oregon Resilience Task Force, with the mission that's indicated right there. You know, basically, how we have this big Oregon Resilience Plan, how do we start implementing it? You can see the link to that report is online. We had to define resilience, and the Oregon Resilience Plan did a pretty nice job of doing this. Sometimes I always thought it was easier to show what resilience is not, because resilience is a really popular buzzword now, and there you can probably find 60 or 70 definitions. The shot on the left is the Fukushima complex before the tsunami, and on the right is after the tsunami. That's a really good example of something that isn't resilient. But for us, we look at this conceptual diagram that Yumi Wong created, and you can see we start out, you know, everything's good, and when the disaster hits, the goal is to A, minimize the amount of time it takes us to recover, and B, when we do recover, we want to be in a better situation than when we started, i.e. we don't just want to rebuild everything in time for the next disaster or rebuild everything to the same standards. So you can see we want to move that line upward and the response time to the left so we're not in as big a hole and we're not taking as long to recover. And we do have a long ways to go. That's why we're doing all this. So what I'm going to finish with is what we did. We issued our Resilience Task Force report, a whopping 2 pages plus a cover letter, in October of 2014, in time for the long legislative session that started this past February. And we had a whole series of lists. We wanted oversight. We were recommending investment in more seismic rehab funding, transportation backbone, a better assessment, inventorying of what we had for multimodal transportation, education, land use, and we got some that we asked for. We got some that we didn't ask for were still useful, and there's still stuff left to do. Our one item that we singled out above all else was creating the position of state resilience officer, which was passed, House Bill 2270. And it's not that we wanted to create another government position. I actually wasn't originally a big supporter of this when it came out, the Oregon Resilience Plan. But, you know, after serving on two of these committees, as have several other people, we realized we needed something besides yet another series of unfunded ad hoc all-volunteer committees. And there had to be someone appointed by the governor, reporting to the governor with some authority and the ability to keep all of the different pieces, land use, funding, codes, education, you name it, on the radar for the governor's office and coordinate all the different entities available. So that was passed. It was signed into law, and now we're working on trying to determine what that position is going to look like and how we're going to fill it. Some measures to assist seismic rehab for multi-occupant buildings, a really large piece, bigger than we expected. The legislature funded, put additional authorization for general obligation bonds to be sold that had been approved by the voters already back more than 10 years ago, more than $200 million for schools and public safety facilities. We made got a kind of foot in the door for addressing some of the healthcare needs and ability to fill prescriptions. And this is what's next. And Dagami, Ian Maiden, the acting state geologist, has committed to moving forward with the DME Board of Governors to adopt the updated inundation maps. It'll move the line that restricts certain types of development a little bit more landward. We know that we need to promote really vigorously the coordination at the state and local level to provide more land use options for communities that are largely in the inundation zone and they don't have a lot of other options for development. We had some bills that did not make it through, but we're looking at other options for the short session, for the next long session, and non-legislatively. We know that the human side, mass care and shelter, access to medical care, that's going to be huge, and whatever solutions we can come up with this would apply to any other disaster. It's a really big piece of this. It's the part of resilience that is really difficult to get your hands on because it doesn't relate to codes. It's a lot more difficult to quantify, but it's still very important. We already talked about the fuel vulnerabilities. A reminder that our Resilience Task Force report was only intended to address, we specified, the first biennium, 2015-17, and to get stuff going. But obviously, this is going to be an ongoing process. And, you know, as an emergency manager, I always like to point to contingency plans. So if you find yourself on the coast in the lovely community of Wheeler, you will find this facility. And with that, I'll thank everyone for tuning in. I'll look forward to the Q&A piece after the presentations are done.